On August 6th, 2011, rioting erupted in Tottenham, North London.
I'm just behind the police lines. The police are coming under attack from fireworks. They've just warned us that petrol bombs are being assembled. So still, and I can see just in the distance a car that was set on fire just about an hour ago.
What ensued was one of the worst cases of mass public disorder in recent history. The rampage of looting, arson and vandalism, mainly conducted by youths, spread throughout London and into several major cities.
A large-scale police operation is underway in Birmingham city centre tonight.
They were scenes not witnessed in Liverpool for a generation.
Look at them.
After the chaos, the clampdown. The police in the centre of Nottingham reclaiming the city after two nights of unrest.
The cleanup's underway in Bristol after cars were set on fire and shop windows smashed as hundreds of people created disorder.
People's homes and businesses lay in ruins.
I came round to the back of the shops through the residential streets and was met by what I can only describe as feral youths, feral rats. Just these teams of young 14, 15, 16-year-olds that were just in gangs on the street.
And at least five people have been killed in the violence.
Riot police stand guard outside a hospital in Birmingham early on Wednesday after three men were run down by a car during the riots. Two men died at the scene and the third succumbed to his injuries after being taken to hospital.
The heart of a suburban shopping centre is now a place where people are coming to remember a life lost. Mr. Mannington Bowes was said to have been set upon as he remonstrated with rioters who'd set fire to an industrial bin.
Politicians were quick to label it pure criminality, with no purpose and seemingly no root cause.
Councillor Brandt, do you accept that, first of all, that this is just sort of opportunistic criminality, people taking the chance to steal something because they can, that there isn't something else beneath this?
I think that is a fair summary, that this is nothing short of pure criminality.
What we've witnessed on the streets of our major towns and cities is nothing more or less than pure criminality and thuggery. And those who seek to excuse this behaviour as being down to deprivation or poverty or current government policies are themselves symptomatic of the no-blame, no-responsibility culture which has undermined our society and led us to this sorry state.
This was not political protest or a riot about protest or about politics. It was common or garden thieving, robbing and looting. And we don't need an inquiry to tell us that.
But what really sparked these riots? And what does the future hold for Britain? On August 4th, Mark Duggan, a 29-year-old father of four, was pulled from a taxi in Tottenham and shot dead by the Specialist Firearms Command. Initial reports from the IPCC claim that one of the officers had been shot and Duggan had to be neutralised. The bullet was found lodged in the officer's chest radio, but following ballistics tests, it was revealed that it couldn't have come from Duggan, because it was a police-issued bullet.
The IPCC are appealing for witnesses, but suggestions that a bullet which was lodged in a police radio was one of their own and had not been fired from another weapon has raised more awkward questions. But people who live nearby told me that a police surveillance vehicle had been filming the road for several days before the shooting. They claim to have seen armed plainclothes police hiding in bushes nearby, and say the taxi in which Mark Duggan was a passenger was taken away from the scene before being brought back later for more tests.
The question remains, if Duggan did not fire a gun at police, why does an eyewitness describe how he was held down and essentially executed?
There is no question this was an execution-style killing.
There is a young man called Mark Duggan. He has parents, he has brothers, he has sisters, and few yards away from where he lives, a police officer blew his head off.
Well, Mr. Howe, we have to...
Let me finish.
Mr. Howe, we have to wait for the official inquiry.
Now, the police seems to have this contempt for people, and I don't think they necessarily needed to have killed the guy, yeah? Yeah, they had apprehended him, right? They was in control, right? There was no need for them to kill him. There was absolutely none, yeah? So basically, they might be surprised that this has happened, yeah? But they still don't seem to have learned their lesson 30 years ago, approximately, what happened Broadwater Farm and Toxworth and them places, yeah? Now, you cannot keep on oppressing people, right?
Tensions between the police and the poor city communities have always been high. The blanket approach to crime and gang culture leaves many people feeling oppressed.
They have been stopping and searching young blacks for no reason at all. I have a grandson, he's an angel, and he began to think he was coming of age when the police slapped him up against the wall and searched him.
Home Office statistics show that black people are far more likely to be stopped and searched based solely on their appearance. In Tottenham, this adds to the distrust.
And he thought he had now had a gold star. I asked him the other day, apropos of a sense that something was going seriously wrong in this country. I said, how many times have the police searched you? He said, Papa, I can't count. There's so many times.
Mr. Howe, that may well have happened, and if you say it did, I am not to gainsay you, but...
In their eyes, the police themselves are a gang that will protect their own before bringing any justice.
That feeling that was passed down from generation to generation that the police are not for us. And as we've seen with events this year, there's been a sense that events such as the student protests and the hostility between young people and the police, then Somali culture, Kingsley Barrow, there is a sense that the police are not for us. And that has manifested even more so in 2011. And as we saw now, the trigger was a young man being killed, arguably from point blank, according to some witnesses.
Since 1998, at least 333 people have died while in police custody. Not one officer has been convicted. It is then understandable why Duggan's community wanted answers.
When we talk about the riots, we still have to go back into the stem of why the riots started. And that's because Mark died, whether people like it or not, whether people know him or not. But he is the reason why everything has started. And right now, when they do pull up stuff about his death and little things that was important at the time, it's like they're not important no more because of the writing and the looting that the media and the government is highlighting more than his death.
We want justice for everybody now!
After being ignored 2 days after Duggan's death on August 6th, the community went to the local police station to exercise their lawful right to protest.
We want answers for the family, for Mark Duggan. We have been given no answers. The family haven't been told anything as to why Mark Duggan was shot on Thursday.
Well, as far as I'm concerned, the protest started quite peacefully, right? There was about 150 people outside the police station, and they was out there. There was five patients. All they wanted was a few answers as to what was happening. The police completely ignored them, you know what I mean, just treated them with contempt. And even at that point, they didn't retaliate.
And right now, the whole of Tottenham's mourning because of that. The whole of the community that know him, they're hurt, which is justifiable. You see what I'm saying? And we need answers.
And what would you say, like, the relationship is like the police now in Tottenham?
Honestly, there wasn't really any relationship with police.
There is no question this was an execution-style killing.
Now the answers has come out that it's true what we were saying. So what we was thinking was true in the start. So it's like, right, hold on. You said one thing and it wasn't even that. Now we're hearing that how, do you see where I'm coming from? He didn't even shoot. So it's like, really, what's going on? You know what I'm saying?
Tension built as police refused to answer questions. All that was needed was a lack of judgment and the crowd would reach a boiling point. It soon came.
And then A young 16-year-old, approximately, went to approach them just to, again, find out roughly what's going on. And they just took some evasive action by pushing her and then drawing their batons. And that's when the people then started to retaliate.
I've been sort of caught in the middle of it since around 5 o'clock this afternoon. And before everything started to kick off, what actually ignited everything is a young female had approached the police standing line, and she was set upon by police with their batons.
What do you mean by set upon?
Well, the police line, they had the line stood there, had actually charged towards her and started hitting her with a baton. Subsequently, it turned out she was only 16, and this absolutely made everyone go up in uproar.
They beat up a girl. They've hit up a girl. The girl's on the floor. The police, have you seen it? Didn't you just see the police stomped at a girl? And then from there, that's all I know. Next minute,
so the police, you say
cars are on fire.
Although the establishment won't like to admit it, the initial catalyst was clearly down to dubious police actions and a culture of distrust between the police and citizens. But what allowed this isolated incident to spark violent looting and rioting around London and into other UK cities?
Listening to my grandson and my son is that something very, very serious was going to take place in this country.
Don't you think it's about time? You've cut up so much supply to youths, right? Connections have stopped, yeah? The job that I'm working in now, I've only got this job up the road at Swinton Insurance, yeah? I only got that job because of connections. You've cut off EMA, okay? You've cut off so much stuff, right? There's a knock-on effect to everything, and look what's happened, right? The youths are running around, okay, stealing, yeah? Now they're looting all this stuff. There's a reason for everything, Boris, okay? And think about the amount of time you are cutting and cutting and cutting, and then you're putting off youth fees, okay? I've got so much friends who actually want to go to university, but I stopped, okay?
Those that say austerity and poverty play no role in the wider context of the riots tend to be politicians trying to defend the cuts, or those that are still living comfortably.
They're all rats.
Funnily enough, Nick Clegg predicted unrest on the streets if an out-of-touch Tory party came to power.
There was a danger in having any government of whatever composition led by a party which doesn't have a proper mandate across the country trying to push through really difficult decisions. I think a lot of people react badly to that.
But rioting in the streets, it's a bit much.
I think there's a very serious risk.
The Tories did come to power, Clegg joined them, and now we have those riots.
But if you looked at young blacks and young whites with a discerning eye and a careful hearing, they have been telling us, and we would not listen, that what is happening in this country to them.
Mr. Howe, if I can.
Although these riots don't seem to have a conscious political aim like the student protests, they are the result of the political decisions made by our leaders.
This is about youth not having a future, not having any kind of possibility of having a future. A lot of these people are unemployed. A lot of these people have their youth centre closed down for years.
It's got to the point where that's it, they can't control us no more. Literally, we see the opportunity, that's it, we run, took everything. No one's got no money around here, so everyone's trying to make as much as they can while they can, you know?
What's your reaction when people say you're nothing but thieves?
Obviously, they've got a lot easier lives than other people around here. Some people have got absolutely nothing, come from nothing.
Haringey, the borough that houses Tottenham, has the fourth highest level of child poverty in London and an unemployment rate of 8.8%, double the national average. There is only one vacancy for every 54 people seeking work. In terms of young people, due to the economic crisis, Britain currently has a record level of youth unemployment. Britain's youth services face cuts of 25%, while Tottenham alone has already been cut by a staggering 75%. It was only in October last year that the BBC warned of youth unrest, similar to what occurred in France in 2005. This was attributed to poverty and lack of opportunities.
and they've basically seen the normal things. The bankers getting away with what they're getting away with, making this country losing money how it does. Let's be honest about it. The police being paid money to do things underhanded to get stories from newspapers, nothing really happened to them. The government being done for what they do, what they've done, their expenses, some of them going in prison, the majority of them been doing it for years. This is the youths actually saying to themselves, guess what? These people can get away with that. Then why can't we tell people how we feel? Look at what you're seeing today. You're not seeing it in one area. You're seeing it right over London. There's a message here. There's a message for the government. They don't care. They ain't even talking about it. They're talking about these thugs, these thugs, that. They're not addressing the real problem that the society has. There's no hope for them. And this is their way of reacting. And I feel genuinely sorry for them. These young kids at 18 year old age, they've got no future. They can't get a job. This is sad. This is a reaction for what the government, not only the Conservative Party now, but the Labour Party that was in power before. They're all in this.
You are spending, okay, hundreds of millions of pounds a week, okay, in Libya, when you could be over here. Sort yourselves out over here first. You haven't finished. Libya, we can't stretch our hands when we can't reach it. I'm sure we'd all love to help in Libya. I'm sure we'd all love to give to people in all those countries who are suffering, but we can't afford it. So don't you think it's about time we actually started concentrating on here?
The hypocrisy of the system knows no bounds. We only need cuts because the government has overspent in our name and bailed out the banks and financial gamblers in the city who crashed the economy in the first place. To put it into context, let's do some math. The estimated cleanup costs of the riots is currently 200 million. The kinetic military intervention in Libya to protect civilians, otherwise known as the invasion to steal oil and to prevent the region from becoming economically independent, has so far cost taxpayers 1 billion. George Osborne, who condemns the looting, just so happened to help Vodafone cancel a 6 billion tax bill, a flagrant looting of the public purse. Ignoring Vodafone and other special relationships, the government itself admits that companies in 2010 avoided 6.9 billion in corporation tax. Why aren't the public calling for water cannons and rubber bullets to be used on them? Is it because they wear suits? And finally, the cost to the taxpayers of bailing out the banks is approximately 850 billion. To be on par with this corporate and financial looting, the feral scum of the inner cities would have to repeat the riots 4,320 times. The unfair system that loots billions from the people has just as much, if not more, explaining to do than those involved in the riots.
The police have not been anywhere. Where have the police? If the police were here, do you think all that would have been done?
I think they need to prioritise themselves a little bit better. I don't think they're doing everything they can. I don't mean they need to be more violent, I think they need to be more competent.
During the riots, many eyewitnesses were shocked at the lack of police intervention. Looters chose to risk it because there was literally not enough officers stopping them. When this became apparent, it caused a copycat approach across the country. On the first day, only 3,000 officers were deployed to protect the people. This is 2,000 less than were on guard at the royal wedding. Of these 3,000, many of them just stood back and watched as the rioting escalated. In some instances, there were direct orders to just stand and observe. It's not surprising they were stretched and confused on tactics. Thousands of police have already lost their jobs to cuts. Even in years before the financial crisis, they had continually faced frontline pressures and increasing red tape. This is why PCSOs were first introduced.
Over the last year, we've seen already a loss of 5,000 police officers, an amazing number, and also a separate report from the Inspector of Constabulary saying over the next few years, we can expect 34,000 police jobs as a minimum to go. That's 16 over 16,000 police officer jobs, over 1,000 police community support officers, and then 16,000 police staff. So it's huge numbers, and I think people will just be frankly astonished.
The question remains, how on earth will they contain any future riots? Perhaps Cameron's big bankrupt society means doing the policing ourselves. Or maybe we should hand it over to the racist English Defence League.
We're the Enfield anti-rioting squad. You want to riot our time, then we'll just have it, mate. We're here to smash you up.
One solution being offered is to privatise policing. But this raises all sorts of questions about accountability and effectiveness. Is it wise to mix justice with profits? And with the current community safety scheme deploying personnel onto the streets after just 2 weeks of training, poor decisions and cases of brutality can only increase. Rioters are now being convicted of their crimes, but some of the bizarre punishments will only re-inflame the situation.
Look, if you are caught being involved in any way in this rioting and in this looting, any single member of your family, we will throw you out of your council houses.
Well, I think that is helpful, frankly, because we've got to find ways of enforcing responsibility in our society. Now, look, if you live in a council house, you're getting a house at a discount from what other people have to pay, and so with that should come some responsibilities.
More than 100,000 people have so far signed one petition suggesting the government should retract all financial benefits being paid to those found guilty of looting. That means it may be one of the first public bills to be debated in the Commons, and may even become law.
Because, of course, making youths homeless and completely penniless is going to get to the root causes of inequality in our society. The 2011 riots were caused by a perfect storm of societal failures. The dubious execution of Mark Duggan and the subsequent refusal to answer the family's questions brought years of injustice to the forefront. The boiling point came when police attacked a young girl. Violence was met with violence, and this ignited a wave of youth rioting all across the country. Crippling austerity measures exacerbated the situation, both on the psychology of the rioters, who now have nothing to lose, and the lackluster police response, who had to deal with low initial numbers and orders to stand and observe while the rioting spread. The perpetrators of the system, and those that desperately cling to it, are refusing to acknowledge this wider context. Politicians do not want to concede that their hypocrisy, their complicity in the corrupt financial system, and their cuts helped create the unequal environment from which the riots developed. The general public do not want to concede that Britain is a failing state, no different to any other European or Arab country, because in doing so, they'd have to admit that sometime in the future, they might have to take to the streets, not by choice, but by necessity. Their collective ignorance is only prolonging their agony. By the time they realise they've been living a lie, it will be too late for rational discussion or workable solutions. Living within our means is all fine and well, but our means are being taken away by bankers and politicians who haven't been living within theirs. It's not the general public that borrow inconceivable amounts to fund illegal wars or to prop up failed utopian dreams like the EU. It's not the general public that gamble with financial derivatives and crash the economy. The UK's national debt to the bankers is currently set at £4.8 trillion and is increasing exponentially. It's the general public that will be living in increasing poverty to foot the bill. It may have been iPods and TVs this time, but what happens when it's food? When you take a loaf of bread, will that be pure criminality, with no root cause? will it be dismissed because it's not political? If people weren't so dumbed down by state-owned and corporate monopoly media, maybe there would be more political action.
First, you've got to get mad. You've got to say, I'm a human being, God damn it! My life has value!
We are all in this together. So why can't we come together and turn our attention to the real culprits? It's not those on benefits, it's not black people, it's not public sector workers or private sector workers, it's not the lower classes, it's not the middle class. And voting any of the political parties next time around won't fix it. The bankers have looted 4,250 times more of the people's money than any of the rioters. And none of your tax money is going to clean up that mess. Yours, your children's, and their children's tax money has already been signed over to the bankers. The sooner people wake up to the reality they live in, the sooner we can address these issues peacefully.
Take my soul, you can't take my soul. You might take my freedom, but you can't take my soul. You can't take my soul.
Whether it's a cancer patient or assassination, no, I fought for emancipation. My intentions were pure, you can't debate them, but no, never ever shook hands with Satan. My fans are amazing, I thank and praise them. When I die, don't cry, just congratulations. A million more feet will stamp the pavement with plans for changes, no exaggeration. We will not be ignored. You'll be rocked with the force of the bombs that you dropped in these wars. I will not be fought, and I consciously thought it was wrong, so I constantly fought. Peace is something I would really adore, but we are at war, so give me a sword. A million